Hello, welcome to Trews. Trews is true news. Subscribe here to receive true news every day. It'll appear inside of your eyelids, danced in tiny molecules of light. That's just looking at things, really. That's just a way of describing what actually happens. Today in the true news, we're talking about Barack Obama. He's in charge of America. He's made a decision to spend $1 trillion on nuclear weapons. Why do they need so many nuclear weapons? A lot of people think we've already got enough. I think there's enough to break everything down if we needed to. If it was like, have we got enough to destroy everything? Yes. Let's not question whether or not that in itself is an unkind and unholy objective. We have got enough to do it. We decided to have a look at Barack Obama's Nobel Prize winning speech. He won the Nobel Peace Prize. The Nobel Peace Prize is awarded to those who have done the most or best work for fraternity between nations, the abolition or reduction of standing armies, and for the holding and promotion of peace congresses. They looked at everyone in the world and they went, right, who's done that the most really out of everyone? I think it's Barack Obama who's done a good job of it. Now that it's done, let's have a look at his Nobel Peace Prize winning speech to see if it makes us, what it makes us feel in our tummies.
I receive this honor with deep gratitude and great humility. It's an award that speaks to our highest aspirations, that for all the cruelty and hardship of our world, we are not mere prisoners of fate.
We're not prisoners of fate. Seems that we're prisoners of the military-industrial complex, though.
The world may no longer shudder at the prospect of war between two nuclear superpowers, but proliferation may increase the risk of catastrophe.
Who's the threat coming from? It's an economic and financial decision. I suppose it says here that in something we got out of the New York Times that when he first came to office, Obama was clear-sighted about nuclear dangers and ambitious about disarmament. And his major arms control achievement was a New START treaty with Moscow aimed at reducing deployment of strategic nuclear weapons to 1,550 on each side. That's still, like are my ambitions as a human being too great? These are them. Peace and harmony among all the Earth's people. Finding common objectives between us all, of which there are many. The majority of us want the same thing. We've got to transcend those kind of ideas. Our ambitions can't be, can we have a few less nuclear weapons? No, that's unachievable, we're getting more.
I'm responsible for the deployment of thousands of young Americans to battle in a distant land. And some will kill, and some will be killed.
Already starting to sound not that peaceful, like even now before we've done the trillions of nuclear weapons. Said by February 2018, to win Republican support for the aforementioned treaty to reduce nuclear arms by a miserable amount, Obama made a Faustian pact promising to spend $84 billion to upgrade aging nuclear weapons. I don't buy this sort of blaming the Republicans. I know the Republicans are a bit worse than the Democrats, but oh, it's the bloody Republicans. You're all basically doing the same stuff.
And so I come here with an acute sense of the costs of armed conflict, filled with difficult questions about the relationship between war and peace and our effort to replace one with the other.
Since he gave this speech, Barack Obama's principles have obviously changed because he's entered into the structures and systems of contemporary politics where this kind of grandstanding, idealistic rhetoric becomes redundant as you enter, I suppose, the economic, financial realities and tribal affiliations of contemporary politics.
Now, these questions are not new. War in one form or another appeared with the first man at the dawn of history.
You don't know that. They don't know what happened at the dawn of history.
The capacity of human beings to think up new ways to kill one another proved inexhaustible, as did our capacity to exempt from mercy those who look different or pray to a different god.
There is a narrow space within which what is normal and orderly is allowed to be discussed and is defined. And here, by saying stuff like that, the dawn of history, it's like the narrativization of what's acceptable. Basically, this speech, even coming when it did, it was like, we're all just, this is the way things have to be. Things have to be a bit like this. Human beings are bellicose, belligerent, warlike people, so the best we can do is see how much money we're gonna spend on nuclear. We're gonna try and limit it, but you know, it's tricky. It's just not true.
In the wake of such destruction, and with the advent of the nuclear age, it became clear to victor and vanquished alike that the world needed institutions to prevent another world war. America led the world in constructing an architecture to keep the peace, a Marshall Plan and a United Nations, mechanisms to govern the waging of war, treaties to protect human rights, prevent genocide, restrict the most dangerous weapons.
You should say, I shouldn't be given this Nobel Prize because really I work for a military-industrial complex that its survival is contingent upon the manufacture of nuclear arms and requires there to be a constant state of flux and conflict. So I'm the wrong man for this award. I'm going to get us in a terrible, terrible, all sorts of scrapes, really. So I won't accept it.
I make this statement mindful of what Martin Luther King Jr. said in this same ceremony years ago. Violence never brings permanent peace. It solves no social problem. It merely creates new and more complicated ones. As someone who stands here as a direct consequence of Dr. King's life work, I am living testimony to the moral force of nonviolence.
I don't watch this and think, oh God, he's really changed, man. Like, he's been corrupted by politics. You just think, there's a milieu of thought, there's a strata, a strand of thought and debate, and it's informed by and controlled by economic interests and powerful bodies, I suppose, whatever it is. I'm not a big mad conspiracy theory person, but I just think that the level of Democrat and Republican is a shield for a different power structure, which is probably easy to trace and observe, economic entities, transnational corporations. I think that's where sort of real power lies. And I think that we have to organize differently. It's like, I think that we have to have, between us, communication, and to develop systems and alternatives where we go, right, remember there's all those lunatics. Okay, yeah, thanks. Well done with your Nobel Peace Prize and your treaty and your $1 trillion of arms investment. Right, okay, we're going to need to get food to people and protect the planet. Yeah, they're not going to help, are they? They're lunatics. So what should we do? But it's like we've got to just sort of ignore them and develop alternatives. There are lots of people that are developing alternatives. Perhaps you should have a look at the Venus Project. People keep telling me about the Venus Project. We'll have a look at that. So, as we've long said here on the Trews, Barack Obama, whoever the Republican one is now, Mitt Romney, David Cameron, Ed Miliband, meaningless facade, all of them maintaining the same structures. We must ignore them and develop our own structures. That is some Trews.
Nose is a tool that is abused to fool you and to leave you scared and confused. Trews is like the news. If the news was true, I want some Trews. Let's have some Trews.